Imagine a NASCAR without the famous 24 car. Imagine a NASCAR where Rick Hendrick didn't land two generational talents in a row. Imagine a NASCAR where Jeff Gordon never signed with Hendrick Motorsports. The concept seems alien. I mean, Jeff Gordon and his Rainbow Warriors were one of the most instrumental groups of people in the history of the sport. When Jeff Gordon came over to NASCAR, he and crew chief Ray Evernham were paired at the hip. And as 1991 and 92 unfolded, Gordon ran the number one Bill Davis Racing Thunderbird in the Busch Series. And in 1992, he had that number one Baby Ruth Ford that is now famous. Now, early in 92, Gordon and Evernham had an ultimatum. Bill Davis was to put together a competitive team for Cup to start in 93, starting with landing a major sponsor by about May of 92. If that first step wasn't taken, they'd look around for a ride for 93 outside. Now, they didn't tell Davis this or Ford, so let's say that they do. And they put together the number 22 Target Ford for Gordon in 93, like Bill Davis was already intending. The immediate change is that Gordon would take the seat that Bobby Labonte would eventually take. Labonte, in a strange butterfly effect, may have actually taken the 24 car, or whatever it turned into, and by 1994 would have been teammates with his brother Terry. Now, I don't think that Gordon would have done as poorly with Bill Davis as Labonte did. Ray Evernham surely would have made that not a reality. But Bill Davis Racing was and is no Hendrick Motorsports. So, Jeff Gordon probably would get a win or two by the end of 1994. It'd be surprising if he got much more than that. Now, it does seem that this change so far has not changed too much outside of Jeff Gordon's career in NASCAR history so far. That is, until 1995. I think that at the point of 94, the Bill Davis experiment would have played itself out. Now, you may wonder why I haven't included Roush yet in this video. After all, once word got out in the garage that Hendrick wanted Wonder Boy, Roush was fighting hard to get him. Well, Ford wouldn't want to lose a talent like Gordon. So I'd say that in 95, with Ford's help, Roush would find a way to keep him under the Ford umbrella, whether that meant getting rid of someone like Ted Musgrave, or adding a whole nother team like they did the next year for Jeff Burton. Now, I think he'd run really well, but in his first year with Roush, the early season growing pains would probably be enough to take him out of championship contention, and he would not be able to catch up to Earnhardt. Meaning that Dale Earnhardt would be the second driver to win three straight championships at NASCAR's highest level, and he'd be the first, and so far only ever, to win 8 championships in his career. Now, while Jeff Gordon would inevitably gain success, the delay compared to our current timeline of his rise would mean that NASCAR would miss out much of the best years of the Gordon vs. Earnhardt rivalry. This would have stunted NASCAR's growth overall. By the time that Gordon would reach a competitive enough level to compete with Earnhardt and threaten his reign, it would have been 1996. This is when the Intimidator's injuries would catch up with him and his career would take a fall off. So around 97, Gordon would probably get his first title and would be completely unchallenged. This storyline taken away would be a huge domino effect when it comes to the buildup of NASCAR in the late 90s and into the new millennium. And this is where I think the floodgates would open for Gordon's career. 1998 would probably play out much like his real life 1998. He'd probably dominate, as Roush Fords were the only thing that could keep up with Hendrick at the time. Now you add Ray Evernham to that, I think you have God status statistics for that season, and there's no way in hell he's losing the championship. But where I see another change is that in 1999, Gordon would be in more durable Roush Fords compared to his 24 car that year. Gordon would possibly get his third consecutive championship and would be the youngest driver to ever do it, just a couple years removed from Dale Earnhardt doing it. As is with 2000, Evernham probably would have left, leading to a similar slumping 2000 season that he had in real life. Now, 2001 may be where the next big change would be. It's no guarantee that Roush would give Gordon a good replacement like Robbie Loomis was for Gordon at Hendrick. Plus, they did have a down 2001 season overall at Roush. So Gordon's 2001 championship may very well have went to someone like Tony Stewart or Sterling Marlin. This leads to another big change. See, with Roush's pipeline being really full at the time, it would mean that other drivers probably couldn't be added to the Cup roster as easily as with Hendrick. So Jimmy Johnson would not probably go to Cup in 2002, or at least not with Hendrick Motorsports. Instead, he might have to wait all the way to 2004 to fill in the second half of the year for Jeff Burton's departure in Cup. And Carl Edwards, well, he might have to wait to replace Kurt Busch. This, unfortunately, would mean that someone like Greg Biffle may not have a place to stay at Roush. Things get completely unrecognizable, in my opinion, would probably be from about 2006 onward. It's safe to say that in our new timeline, Jimmy Johnson probably isn't going to get 5 championships in a row. But he would definitely get a share of wins, and I think he would still get some titles. Gordon, too, would probably be still at Roush and still be the team to beat. But at this point, teams like Hendrick, Gibbs, or even Penske or Richard Childress probably could catch or surpass them. But one thing is definitely certain. The 2000s would look much more competitive, at least on paper. The ripples also include free agency. For instance, Dale Jr. may not have ever went to HMS, and if he did, he might have been the top dog. Haas with Tony Stewart may not have had an alliance with Hendrick. Maybe they would have had it with somebody like a Gibbs or like a Roush. Maybe the alliance never happened. Now, due to how old school Roush is, I think they still would have fallen off. Even people like Mark Martin have said as much, that Roush was very old school and it led to their demise. This also means that I think Gordon's career would have fallen off as well. So who knows? You know how he finished his career pretty well, all things considered? Maybe instead of finishing like that, he would have finished more like a Matt Kenseth or a Tony Stewart, kind of just withered away over time and then finally retired. The big difference for Roush is that when the Cat in the Hat decided to hang it up, instead of Brad Keselowski taking partial ownership, maybe it was Jeff Gordon taking control of the team, and maybe Fenway wouldn't have jumped on. That's something that very well could have happened. So maybe the long-term health of Roush would have been a lot better had Jeff Gordon stayed with the Ford tree all along. Now, I want to say that I also think that the mainstream appeal of NASCAR over this time would not have been as strong had Gordon not been in the 24 car. How that affects where the sport is today would be huge in terms of overall popularity, money, maybe where the cars are at, who knows, maybe even the size of the schedules. The driver landscape would be completely unrecognizable right now compared to today as well. Jeff Gordon's decision to go behind Bill Davis's back and sign with Rick Hendrick may have been one of the best and most influential decisions in the history of NASCAR, maybe even in the history of motorsports. And with that, I want to pass all of this stuff, all of this hypothetical stuff, on to you. What do you think would have happened had Jeff Gordon not signed with Hendrick Motorsports? Let me know down in the comments below. All right, be sure to drop a like in this video, share this video, and subscribe to my channel for more NASCAR content like this. And until next time, have a good one.